Okay, we're live here. Getting a good bandwidth today, thanks to the Department of Education Wi-Fi hookup that I got the password to. Thank you very much. Be prepared, everybody, for a PR kind of bullshit storm from the Navy. Might have heard that the that's what we're here to find out. Here's the speaking area. As you can see, what they've done is kind of sealed off the auditorium. There we go. We got people with signs here, and signs in process at the moment. There is a problem people want it fixed. I mean, what can you say? There's also the Thielen, Lawrence, and Theo. Also saw Breen Harimoto earlier. The Sierra Club is here, but will the people get to talk? That's the question. They had a poster area in the back with thousands, I shouldn't exaggerate, with the whole Navy PR battalion unit, so we'll find out what people have to say. It's not going to be a very cordial welcome, but we're going to try and get the details to this and also to communicate the fact that we're not very happy. We, meaning the people, not very happy about the pollution of the fuel and the Navy's lack of enthusiasm in fixing the problem. The State Department of Health is here. The Honolulu Board of Water Supply has been very good at monitoring the situation, reporting it, and urging that the Navy do something. They have no enforcement capability, though. That's the problem. I see people from the State Department of Health who were Chang, his name was, who was totally useless last time. If you joined us a couple months ago. Okay. There are 20 million gallons of jet fuel in these 20 tanks, and the tanks themselves we know are leaking, and they sit 100 feet above the aquifer, meaning the underground fresh water drinking water supply for the island of Oahu, which houses most of the population here in Hawaii. So it affects perhaps a million people, at least several hundred thousand people.
My name is Keith Honolulu. I'm the Deputy Director for Environment and Health, Department of Health. And on behalf of the Department of Health, Environmental Protection Agency, the U.S. Navy, and Defense Logistics Agency, welcome to this informational meeting on the Red Hill Naval Fuel Supply Facility and the Administrative Order of Consent. First of all, thank you for taking time off of your busy schedule to attend tonight. I know it's a tough thing to take off on a weeknight, but I really appreciate your attendance. So tonight we will go through the AOC, as it's called, Administrative Order of Consent, which was signed last year in October. And we'll go over the status of the AOC, each of the parties involved in the AOC will give a short briefing of what the status is, and then we'll open up to questions and answers. After that, we'll still see some time to go back to the posters. We'll have the people that are remaining those posters be able to talk one-on-one with each of you, if you so desire.
Right now, we'll have
a Kalana Finn to moderate the meeting.
Thank you, Keith. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Red Hill Informational Public Meeting. Again, as Keith shared, my name is Kaulana Finn, and I am a private citizen this evening, serving in an individual capacity, which means I'm just here to help moderate this evening's meeting and keep us all on track. So I just wanted to go over a few housekeeping things areas that, first of all, most importantly, the bathroom. So if you look to the right, your right, and towards the west, you will see the female's bathroom is straight out there. You can see the light is on. Beyond that, you're going to see a statue, and that is where the men's or the boys' bathroom is. So if you need to go at any time, you know where those things are. So that everyone is able to see, especially those in the back, we'd like to ask folks to please keep your signs at shoulder level if you have any. And a reminder, if you have a question to ask or if you would like to submit a question on an index card, please do so at the back of the room there. And just as a reminder, so the purpose of this meeting is to allow for the public to be providing progress updates by the Navy, Defense Logistics Agency, and the regulatory agencies and to ask questions specifically about the Red Hill facility. So once again, thank you everyone for your reverence as information is shared throughout this evening. And at this time, we'd like to move forward with a presentation by Captain Ken Epps, Commanding Officer, Fleet Logistics Center, Pearl Harbor. And he's going to start with a short video that he'll tell you about.
Right. Thank you very much, and good evening, everyone. My name is Captain Ken Epps, and I'm the Commanding Officer of the Fleet Logistics Center here in Pearl Harbor. Next to me is Captain Rich Hayes. He is the Commanding Officer of Naval Facilities Engineering Command Hawaii. And together, both of our commands are responsible for operating, maintaining, updating, and providing the science and engineering expertise for all things Red Hill. So we are here to represent the Navy writ large, and we are standing in for our boss, Rear Admiral John Fuller. As our moderators shared, we're going to give you an update on where we are with Red Hill since the AOC was signed last October. And we built it purposely very high level to give you a sense for what has happened. We've obviously met with a lot of the community and different stakeholders over the last year, so we tailored our approach to answer the most common questions that we've had about Red Hill and the concerns about the AOC over the last 12 months. So hopefully we will answer most of your questions within the confines of the 10 minutes that we get, but I think the richest experience that we'll have tonight will come from the Q&A session later on today. So we'll look forward to that. Sure. Before we start, though, we wanted to share something with you all. So we had a video of Red Hill. Obviously, Red Hill is a Navy facility, and so it's not necessarily open to the public. And so what we've had for about 10 plus years is a video that you can see on Vimeo or YouTube, which is about 14 minutes long. I think I see some heads nodding here, so many of you may have seen it. And it gives you a great history and the background to the why Red Hill, into the how it was built, and then kind of took us up to about the mid-90s. So this last year, we wanted to update the video, and it's about 95% done. It's in the final production phase now. So we weren't ready to unleash it on the public tonight as our grand premiere, but what we have for you is a little bit of a teaser. So we've got a 3-minute video. Unfortunately, it's a bit raw footage, but what the intent of showing this with you is to give you a sense of what Red Hill looks like and the scope and the scale. Because looking around this room, I've taken a number of folks into the mountain, and so I know that they have a sense of the scope and the scale. But hopefully after you watch this quick montage, you'll get a better feeling for what the facility is like, how big it is, and the entirety of the scope. So with that, if I can ask someone to maybe dim the house lights, and we'll start rolling. This is where the previews are supposed to be.
This is the cartoon.
So I think we have a backup disk. So if someone doesn't have it on their hard drive, I think we've got a backup disk that we can pop into the laptop and hit play here. than 30 seconds, we may have to punt on this. So I'm looking around at my folks who are supposed to have this video, and I'm getting a big goose egg. So anybody with a disc that they can pull out? Okay.
Okay, this is a great way to start.
I spent way too much time talking and meeting with people and not making sure we had the video lined up, so I apologize for this, folks. I got y'all excited and then I kind of let you in here.
This okay, really builds our confidence.
So we have the DVD.
Oh, here's the disc. Okay, hang on, folks. Okay, we are waiting for a video presentation to start. We're live from Honolulu Elementary and Middle School, which is near Red Hill. It's up down the street from Tripler Hospital. Here we go. Confidence is building.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and punt on this. So if there was, if you just take a look at this snapshot right here, this gives you a quick sort of two-dimensional sense of how big each tank is. So why don't we hit stop on here? It's going to stutter and not work. So I apologize, folks. So I'm going to have to fill in a little bit of the gap here, but I think most of you probably know, so I'll be quick. So Red Hill consists of 20 tanks that look just like this from the inside. I like to use as a reference that each one of them, you can put the Aloha Tower in each one of those. So it's 250 feet high by 100 feet wide, and it holds a little over 12.5 million gallons of whatever petroleum product we can put in there. The great takeaway from this trailer was supposed to be, and what I hope to fill in here, was this is an enormous facility. There is nothing like it on the globe anywhere. This is the only one, it's the largest of its kind in the US, in the Department of Defense, and it's the largest such facility in the entire globe. So I will plant that there now, and we'll come back to that thread in the narrative later on, but it speaks a lot to timelines. I was speaking with a couple of legislators here recently, and they were asking me about timelines. And I told them that we want to get this done as quickly as possible. But at a certain point, the laws of physics work against us. And I said, it's like flying across country. Mathematically, it takes 6 hours to fly from New York to LA, and you can fly in a faster jet potentially. But you get the point I'm trying to make here. At a certain point, because of the scale and because of the complexity of Red Hill, it is a ginormous operation. So we just share that with you, and we'll add some more to this later on, to give you a sense for why this can't happen overnight, but we will certainly expedite and accelerate the work as much as we possibly can do over the time it takes to complete this AOC. So any questions before I turn it back to the narrator, just on this one visual that I've left you? I know it's a little bit of a letdown. Again, I built it up and then I let you all down. But if there's anything that you all want to ask, just in terms of this, if not, I'll turn it back to the narrator, and then I'll be available for questions later on.
Perfect. Thank you, Captain Epps. Thank you so much. It's amazing how much you rely on technology nowadays, and sometimes it has its moods. And now there will be a presentation from Steve Linder with the Environmental Protection Agency, and Stephen Chang with the State Department of Health.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm Steve Linder from US EPA. I manage the underground storage tank program for US EPA Region 9. Our headquarters office is in San Francisco, and we have a field office here in Honolulu. I'm out from San Francisco with several of my colleagues. I can just quickly introduce them over here. Omer Shalev, Bob Palarino. I've got a consultant here, Ron Chin. And Dean Higuchi is out of our Honolulu field office. He's somewhere over there. Back in the back. Steve, do you want to introduce quickly, if you record the OH team.
Hello, my name is Stephen Chang. I'm with the Department of Health. I'm the program manager of the Solid Hazardous Waste Branch. We have quite a few individuals here in the meeting today from my office. My boss is here, Stuart Guevara. Raise your hand. He's the division chief of all of our environmental management programs. I see Roxanne Kwan, head of my Rock Search Tank section. Grace Simmons, head of my solid waste program. Grace, you can raise your hand. Joanna Cito, she's the branch chief for the Safe Drinking Water branch. I also have Rich Takala, stand up, Rich. He's with the USD program, and two Perry, she's a public participation coordinator. So this is just a group of people. We also have other people from the drinking water branch. Bob Whittier, a geologist. Mark Frazier, another geologist. And I'm sorry if I missed anybody else, but these are people that are working very hard to review all the products the Navy is presenting to us, and we're working in collaboration with the EPA Region 9.
Great, thanks, Steve. So at the end of the presentations and the question and answer period, we'll probably have some time back at the poster board, so don't be shy trying to introduce yourself and ask us all the hard questions that I'm sure you have for us. So let's next slide, Steve. So, again, you heard a little bit about the facility. Why are we all here? Well, one of the issues is this is a very unique problem. This is a very unique facility. There's nothing else like it anywhere in the world. It is huge. People have a hard time kind of really understanding how big it is until you actually go there and see it. And I have never seen anything like this. It's a unique design, it's a unique construction. So there's no off-the-shelf technologies that you could just go and put in Red Hill. Like, it's not like the corner gas station where there are tens of thousands of them, or actually hundreds of thousands of them across the country. This is a one-of-a-kind facility. It's located up in Red Hill. It was mined into the volcanic rock. It's essentially big concrete vessels that range from towards the bottom, 4 feet thick, up to about 2 feet thick of concrete towards the top, with a steel liner inside that essentially is designed to prevent fuel from leaking out into the concrete. So currently the facility stores both jet fuel and diesel. In the past they stored aviation gas and motor fuel. That was way back in history. So the facility did have leaks, and that 2014 release is really what got our attention at EPA. We joined forces with the state and negotiated the administrative order on consent. It just passed its 1 year birthday, and really the reason why we're here tonight is to talk about all the work we've been doing associated with that agreement. So next slide. So one thing I want to emphasize is the drinking water is safe. It never has been unsafe, but there is contamination in the groundwater beneath the tanks. And it's a big difference between drinking water wells and monitoring wells. Monitoring wells are designed to monitor pollution. So you put them in the areas where you think that you're going to find pollution. They're typically very discreet, very short screens to find the pollution and monitor that. Drinking water wells are much larger and designed to produce clean drinking water. So the water is tested. We've never seen any signs to indicate that the drinking water is unsafe. Next slide. So why did Tank 5 leak? So defects were found in the steel liner, one of the tanks. The repair work on tank 5 essentially had problems. The quality control on the repairs, from what I've seen, was not adequate, and it led to the leak. So was quality controlled by both the contractor and the various government agencies overseeing the work. EPA was not in the process at that point, or the state overseeing the contract work. It was the Navy and the Defense Logistics Agency. They are the ones responsible for the for these tanks. And these leaks were amplified by a couple of other issues. The alarms that were not immediately responded to, and the process for filling the tanks. So next slide. So what are the objectives of the AOC? The objectives are to protect the drinking water, to ensure that actions are taken by the Navy and DLA to reduce the risk of future releases. And how are we going to do that? So we want to understand the likelihood and consequences of potential releases. This facility is old. We've heard people speculate on issues related to future failures. There could be a big earthquake and the tank could break open. Well, what is the likelihood that that would happen? We've got scientists and engineers looking at the design, how the tank was constructed, the conditions of the tanks, to really get a good technical sense of the likelihood of various different types of failures that could occur. And then the Navy is required to implement the best technologies and practices to reduce the risk to the maximum extent practicable. Next slide. So the process involves work related to studying the tank infrastructure to look and come up with the best solutions to make sure that the tank infrastructure holds the fuel and does not have releases. In addition to that, we're looking at the environmental conditions, both in terms of what's already in the environment, but also what is the environment like? If something ended up leaking out of the tank, where would it go? How fast would it go? Where would it end up? Would some of it degrade? Would all of it degrade quickly? Petroleum gets released all the time. In a lot of cases, I've seen hundreds of cases, and most of them you see a certain degree of degradation. If petroleum didn't naturally degrade, there would be drinking water wells all over the place contaminated, but we don't see them there.
Yes, we do.
Next slide. So this slide gives a sense of the work that's being done. There are several different sections of the AOC. I'm not going to go through this in detail. Next slide. But I also wanted to describe some of the other work we've done outside the AOC. So EPA and the state hired a team of experts to go and comb through the whole facility back in May and look at all various different aspects of the facility that could be visually inspected and that could be in records and data systems that could be reviewed. We're still in the process of finishing that review back in our offices, but generally what I was hearing from these experts that go and look at petroleum systems all over the world is that at least what they could see, the operations of this facility typically exceed anything they would see in the private sector. That's so we're hoping to have the report available early 2017. Now, next slide. So as part of this process to study the various different aspects of the facility and the environment and upgrade technologies, we've been involved in numerous meetings. We brought in external experts. We've engaged with the Honolulu World Water Supply. They've brought several experts both in-house, and they have contractors working for them that are looking at the work that the Navy's doing and giving us at EPA and DOH feedback and comments. And so it's a fairly large team of people that are looking at work being done and trying to assure that it is top quality. A large portion of the work, all of the AOC deliverables are all available on both EPA's website and DOH's website. The deliverables are mainly on ours. The data is all on DOH's website. So I urge you, if you want a lot of detailed information, there's a lot of information there, but we have all of that, say, most important information available. People can look at it. Feel free, if you have any questions about it, to give one of us a call. We can explain it. And that's our goal, is to make all this information available to whoever has any interest in looking at it and seeing all the work that we're doing. This just gives a summary of all the various different parties and experts involved. We have hired several companies, and we have the University of Hawaii involved. The Board of Water Supply has several experts working for them, and the Navy has also hired several experts. So it's a very large effort, and that's really what we're here today to talk about, is all the work that's proceeding. Slide. So what to expect next? People have probably heard there's new monitoring wells that are in the process of being installed. Two of them are just completing. Two additional wells are in the process of getting agreements to start drilling, and likely be additional wells beyond these wells. We just finished a meeting couple of days ago on scoping out, trying to figure out how to do some destructive testing of the steel tank shell. There's work being done to non-destructively test the metal. It's kind of like, think about like an x-ray technology where you scan the plates and look for defects in the backside. And we are basically working with the Navy and experts to come up with a program to verify that the technology is extremely accurate for Red Hill, so cutting out sections and looking at the backsides of the piece of metal to make sure that scanning technology is accurate. Just to let you know, the first big tank upgrade decision that we expect to make is probably sometime in mid-2018. So again, more information, our website, send an email to redhill@epa.gov. We're monitoring that mailbox, or if you want to talk to somebody, you can give to Perry at DOH a call. She's right back there, and she can direct you to the right person to answer your questions.
Is that slide presentation to be online?
Thank you, Mr. Linder and Mr. Chang. Next is a presentation from Captain Rich Hayes, Regional Engineer, Commander, Navy Region Hawaii, and Captain Ken Epps, Fleet Logistics Center, Pearl Harbor.
Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome. Rich and I are gonna do a quick presentation up here. We've got about 10 minutes, plus or minus. And so we've only got a couple of objectives that I wanna go over with you, so if you can hit my slideshow and go to the agenda. Next slide, please. So there are three things that we want to hopefully convey and accomplish tonight, and I will try to gauge by your questions later on and your facial tics now if we're getting the message across to you. And the first one is sort of the Navy and the environmental stewardship. The combination of the two, our relationship and what we're doing here on Oahu vis-a-vis environmental stewardship. The second one is a quick update. Steve Linder told you what happened with Tank 5, and I elaborate a little bit on it to give you some more context and background, and then we'll tell you what we've done in the last year to remediate that and where Tank 5 sits today. And then finally, I like to call the last slide, just three slides, the why Red Hill. So it's the strategic part of this brief. I've got three bullets to it, But the takeaway from that is going to be, why Red Hill, why Oahu, why here, why are we all meeting here tonight dealing with this? And hopefully off that slide, that would give you a sense of the purpose of Red Hill, why it is here, why it's important to us after that. So next slide. So the Navy and environmental stewardship, and if I just had one sentence and 15 seconds up here to convey one thing to you, it would be the first bullet that I have up there. And that is that the drinking water on Oahu is safe, it has been safe, it is safe today, and the Navy is committed to keeping it safe. If I had nothing else to share with this group tonight, that is the only thing I would say to you. Now, obviously, we're sitting here representing the region, but we had a meeting this morning, and I shared with the audience there. In some ways, I wish I could have come here tonight not in uniform, because in some ways, it creates this artificial barrier. There's this sense that there's this Navy, and that there is us. And what I wanted to convey this morning, and what I want to convey tonight, is there is no separating line between the Navy and us. Here at all, in terms of where we live, in terms of where the water is consumed, in terms of our care for Oahu. So if nothing does not come through tonight with respect to that, at least my attempt is to try to convey that to the audience here. We are very, very concerned about environmental stewardship, our protection of it, the things we do. And so since the last year, our entire efforts vis-a-vis Red Hill have all been about risk management. Monitoring, assessing, and studying. You know, based on our one release that I'll talk about on the last slide, the things we've learned from that one release, we want to make sure we can apply that going forward so that we don't repeat that again. But now, in conjunction with DOH and EPA, we are doing the AOC. Within that, we have a number of studies and practices that we do. So as an example, I think many of you know this, but we have regular and frequent periodic water testing, both right around the facility and both in the drinking water as well. And I want to differentiate the two real quickly for you. So once a month, we have monitoring wells around Oahu, and they literally are holes that we dug in a strategic place by the facility that's about, I don't know, maybe 300-400 feet in the ground. And what it allows us to do is tap into the groundwater beneath Red Hill and do a quick check. And you don't have to be a scientist to know that oil and water don't mix. So what we do is we take a ladle, or we take what I like to call a turkey baster, and we suck off the top of the water once a month. And that is the quickest, most physical way we can tell if anything is coming off the mountain. So we do that once a month now. It's just we haven't always done that. We do that because that would be our first red flag if we saw any kind of oil in the water in those monitoring well tests. And so far, that hasn't been the case. And then quarterly, we do a more exhaustive test of the drinking water. And this is when you hear people talk about there are 2 parts per billion of so-and-so in the water. We take samples from the drinking water supply, so this is the key component here, and we don't test it. So we just take it off, we mail it off to an independent lab on Oahu, who are not military or government related, and they do the test, they give us the results back, and the results tell us, this is what you have in the water here, you know, this is what the water looks like compared to maybe the water in Hawaii or maybe in the North Shore. And we can give a breakdown of what's in there. And the key indicator there is there's a certain threshold that you have to hit where alarms start going off, and this is where DOH and EPA come in. So every quarter we do this test, it's very comprehensive, we send it off, and the results are sent back, they just come through us and go right to DOH and now EPA, and those results are in the public domain, located on their website, and you're free to look at it. And that's those tests that we've been doing since 2008, and then we continue to do today, and then we'll continue to do going forward, have told us and allow us to write that opening statement that the drinking water in Oahu is safe, and we hope to continue to keep it safe. We have 2 other things that we're doing. One is we're studying the groundwater around Red Hill. This is a little bit more science fiction and new. So what we want to do is make sure that we're smart about the investments in monitoring that we do around the facility. So an easy thing would be go every 10 feet and do a perimeter, and you know for sure you're checked in there. But the cost of that would be extraordinary, and it probably wouldn't be the most sensible way of doing things. Groundwater flows a certain way, and there are people who study this, geologists, who know how that happens. So we are conducting studies now so that in the future, we can do two things. One, we can pop in monitoring wells in the right place. So we're not looking for a needle in a haystack. We know darn well that that needle falls in the haystack where it's going to fall. We'll put the monitoring well in that location. And the second issue here is that if we do, for whatever reason, have some kind of catastrophe, we can then project and monitor and help inform what we would do to mitigate that. Because now that we know that, hey, if something were to happen, the water would flow a certain way, we're not chasing our tail around Red Hill, we know exactly where that goes. So that's the second part of the study, that once we're done with the AOC, we will be a lot smarter about that. And then finally, we do soil vapor analysis. So I'm not a scientist. The way I kind of remember is like taking a divining rod, you know, the thing you can take out in the desert, and if you walk over water, it'll start bending a little bit. So we have vapor analysis monitors in the facility that if there are any kind of unusual vapor activity that would come from petroleum or non-natural acting substance, they would trigger off, and again, they would let us know that, hey, something is wrong here. We shouldn't have these white flags come up. And that's yet another way for us to know if there's any problems around the hill. So taken together, we have also invested significantly. A lot of folks who come to the mountain, and the video would have shown you this. We're going to try to download it and maybe play it at the end. But people think this thing has been around since 1940, and they envision this crumbling infrastructure inside with cobwebs and rust. And it could not be any further from the truth. But the most impressive thing we have in the facility is the latest and greatest technology. As Steve said, when their EPA guys came in and looked at the facility, it met or exceeded the standards for any facility out in the private sector, whether you were at ExxonMobil or Chevron or, you know, Royal Dutch Shell, you name it. But the technology that we've invested in there is the most state-of-the-art technology you have on the planet with respect to petroleum management. And I will just give you one takeaway on that. So I told you earlier, each tank in Red Hill is big enough to fit an Aloha tower in there, 12.5 million gallons. The sensors we have inside each tank are accurate enough to determine if we have an unplanned movement of fuel, if we lose something or something goes off by 1/16th of an inch. Now for those who've taken that tour, they know I've done this before. I'll do this little thing, and I'll walk them in there, and when you're in the tank, I'll show it to you again. From a math perspective, it's extraordinary how sensitive those sensors are in there. So we have the technology. We'll talk a little bit more on the next slide by why the technology didn't fail us. Humans failed us on tank 5, but we have the technology in Red Hill. We have the ability to track and monitor the petroleum. We are very comfortable that we know what's in there, what's going in and out, and we can do that well into the future. And so my takeaways bumper sticker on here is that, you know, we don't see environmental stewardship as something that is done a Navy thing. You know, there is teamwork and collaboration that we do with all the equity stakeholders, community leaders, people in the science industry, the regulators, and obviously you, the public here. So we are very, very committed to continuing that teamwork and collaboration. And the most important part, the thing I want to kind of foot stomp here, is the transparency. So we are absolutely committed. Adam Fuller reminded us today before we came out this morning that if we forgot nothing, don't forget to remind folks that he and his bosses are absolutely committed to full transparency on what we're doing in the mountain now, what we plan to do in the mountain going forward, and all the things that we do with EPA and DOH, who are regulating us. We are the regulatees, they are the regulators. All the things that will be done within the confines of the AOC and SOW will be in the public domain. We have a depository that will store all the information. So there will be absolute transparency with every one of you in here, and I have not a shadow of a doubt about that statement today, and even if I'm not here, you know, when this all is done. Okay, so with that, let's go to the next slide. I'm gonna open this up and turn it over to Captain Hayes really quickly. So, prior to all this happening, we have been upgrading in Red Hill. And so it's a big facility. And again, we've had it since 1940. So what we do is, we go into a tank and we do a complete refurbishment. We take that thing inside and out. I liken it to having the guys from CSI with the white suits come in, and they touch and monitor every square centimeter of these tanks, which you got a quick snapshot of, are enormous. Then they have their x-ray machines that come in there and can do the minute micrometer tests to see that if any of the steel lining inside there has been ruptured, any kind of nooks, crannies, anything that we have to repair. It takes a lot of time to do that, and we are usually very careful and very thorough with it. And the Navy doesn't do that. We hire outside contractors, people who do this for ExxonMobil for a living. We bring them in to do that.
They never.
It takes 3 years for one of these tanks, a single tank, to do a complete clean, inspect, and repair cycle. So that's to get those guys in there, the guys and gals in there, the white suits, touch every square centimeter, label and annotate where we have problems, take their machines and do a second count to make sure we didn't miss that, determine what's wrong, go do the repairs, re-examine it again to make sure it's done, and then finally sign it off as, hey, we essentially have a brand new tank. And that's kind of the process. 3 years to do that for each tank. We had gone through five tanks up until 2014. All of them have passed the flying colors, no problem, okay? We get to the sixth tank. That is tank number five. It's the sixth of the one that we do. It was tank number five. Same thing. Had the guys come in their CSI suits. They ran through everything. They said, hey, we got some stuff in here we need to just fix up and patch up. Let's do that. We had the QA process and we thought we were done. So 3 years later, hey, we're good to go. The first five were good. The sixth one ought to be good, right? We go back to fill that tank up and the alarms go off. So I told you, each one of those tanks has a sensor in there that is 1/16th of an inch sensitivity if something goes awry. And so the alarms went off. And here's fault number one. We did not pay attention to it. And what happened was, and I'll use a human example here, it was akin to you taking your car into the dealer for your 25,000 mile service check. You got everything checked out, all the wires are put in, new spark plugs, oil change, you got all that, you got a brand new car. As soon as you drive off the lot, your check engine light goes off. I'm gonna say this for you, I'm gonna guess 9 out of 10 people would sit there and thump their glass in their car. You will,
yeah. So you're going on and on. And
you are going on
really
and on.
You're not impressed a lot of this.
Okay.
You can see it in the slide. We want to talk.
Right, well, we will give you 5 more minutes and we'll get there, okay?
And then no more guys. No more,
Ma'am, we'll have time to answer those questions. Just give it time to finish.
Okay, if I can say, though, the reason I'm bringing this up is because a lot of, you may know this, but a lot of folks have asked about the what behind tank number five. So I apologize if you already know this and this is taking up your time, but there are a lot of folks here who didn't want to answer. So I'll try to speed it up there. Mm-hmm. So you thumb on it and you hit the check engine light and hey, this is good to go. So we ignore that. It came to find out that the contractor did faulty work, they created more of the problem. And so when we had it, there were holes and wells that were improper. So bad number one, we didn't QA it properly. Bad thing number two, we went to fill it in and all these things lasted up, but the thing that is the ultimate catch-all worked. The alarms went off, and we ignored them because we thought this can't be true. This is a brand new tank. That is how we had the accidental release of 27,000 in January 2014. So I'm going to turn it over to Captain Hayes. He'll rush through here much more quickly and tell you what we've done since then.
Thank you, Ken. So just real quick, what have we done with that tank and what are we going to bring it back into service? So we had the contractor mentioned there was a human error with that, the management of the contract. We did have him come back in and do warranty work on that tank, go back over every one of the patches he made. We brought in a third party independent inspector to watch over his shoulder to make sure that those repairs were done and done safely. So now that he's finished that work, it is certified to come back into service. However, because we had issues with that contractor, we've gone out and we are hiring a separate contractor to go back through that three-year process that Captain Epps talked about is a clean inspect and repair. Well, the tank is already clean right now, so we hired another contractor to come in and do another inspect portion of that phase. We anticipate that will take a year to go back in there with those white suits, go back in there, rescan it, just so we can know in this past 5 years that that tank has been empty, has there been anything new that's occurred? And again, I can have just another data point to ensure that there hasn't been any further damage or there's no other holes in the tank. So once we inspect that, if there is any additional repairs that need to be made, we'll move on and make those repairs. Again, that's our commitment to ensure that we do this right and that we're committed to keeping the drinking water safe. In addition, if we look back and we looked at our lesson learned, hey, what did we do? What could we do better? So with the Navy, I'm on NAFAC, Naval Facilities Engineering Command, we administer the contract. So we've looked at the way we wrote that contract, and we've made changes. We've looked at the way that we did our own quality assurance of the contractor's quality control work, and we've made changes there. And we're going to apply that to the next, the follow-on work here that we're going to do in Tank 5 and to all the future tanks that we put through the same cycle. In addition, I'll speak a little bit to Captain Epps, he's the fuel guy, but they looked at how they refilled the tanks, and he talked to you about how the alarms went off. So we're going to take a more
more measured approach. So the human factor, so we have upgraded all our standard operating procedures so that everything we do now, we did everything right by the book except ignore the alarms. And so what we've done is we built in a redundancy. We're going to slow down as we fill up the tank. We used to fill, let's say, 10 gallons, stop, wait, measure, make sure it's good, another 10 gallons. In essence, we've slowed it down. We'll do 5 gallons now, stop, wait, check, and fill it up that way. Slower and less efficient, but we think it's a prudent approach to making sure.
Will the public get the notification of the alarm? Do we get to hear the alarm? Will the alarm go off? Or do we have to depend on you saying, well, maybe it's better if the public doesn't know because they'll panic and act weird and they'll try
well,
and...
I'll tell you, sir, if you live near Red Hill, you won't be able to hear that alarm. So I don't know where you live.
I don't live on Red Hill.
Okay, so we don't have a system now to do kind of a...
There'll be no automatic information to the public if the alarm thresholds are exceeded.
Not true.
Is that correct?
Not true. Because if we have a release, if we determine, so let me tell you real quick now, an alarm does not mean a leak. So remember your high school, high school science, sir.
We don't care. We want to hear the alarm.
I got you. So the chemistry there, get some false alarms based on that. So what we would do is if we get an alarm, we check it. If we do have a release, you will know because we have to immediately notify DOH. So the public will know.
Well, so it's not an automatic.
We'll talk more about that in the QA about maybe breaking that process. So I'm with you on that one. But we have a way of notifying the public if we do have a release. Okay, so final slide, and I'm going to get off the stage so we can get to the part here. So again, the sort of why Red Hill, I don't think there's anyone out here who does not appreciate that the Pacific is the most dynamic region on the planet today, and certainly for the foreseeable future. And when I mean dynamic, I don't just mean business-wise, I mean geopolitically, all the things that are happening out there, there's a lot going on. And so for the foreseeable future, our commitment, our presence is going to be here in Hawaii. There's no change there at all. So why is this important? At a moment's notice, all the services, Army, Air Force, Navy, Marines, and the Coast Guard through the Department of Transportation need to be able to react in a massive way if we have to, for a number of different cases. We could have a major military mobilization if someone were to threaten us at Hawaii, or threaten one of our allies, or threaten the mainland. But, and this is more prescient because this is happening right now as we sit here, as the case you have in Haiti right now, we have carriers and ships going down to Haiti as we speak because of the potential damage from the hurricane that is going through there.
I spent 5 years in Haiti, and I can tell you that the U.S. did not do what they did. They raped the people. I can tell you I worked there a person. So this is not...
Ma'am, in the best interest of time,
no,
there's
no
human statement. Can we have Captain Epps, please?
Yes, ma'am. Maybe we can talk more about that, but what I'm saying here is the Navy is going down in a very limited scope to help out people in an emergency situation. Right. So we are here poised to support that if it were to be the case. And so you combine the need to be able to move at a moment's notice, move a lot of stuff, and get a lot of stuff moving quickly, with the fact that, again, Hawaii's geographic location is what sets it apart. There is nothing else between the mainland and any points east that if we have to move a lot of stuff in a very short amount of time from east to west or west to east, we're the only gas stop in town. Anywhere, and when I say town, I mean the entire Mid-Pacific. So we have a strategic need to make sure that we have that product there on reserve in case we have to mobilize in a quick fashion, and just even day to day. So obviously, you know, 80% of our commerce that comes to Hawaii comes by ship, and it's imperative that the trade and sea lanes are kept open from between the mainland to points west to be able to keep both the information, resources, and commerce moving at all times. So my closing on here is, so the why Red Hill? Red Hill feels like, you know, there are no other options now or in the foreseeable future to be able to support those movements. I sometimes hesitate to use the term national security, because when you do that, it's like I'm throwing this trump card down. Like, hey, who's going to question me on that now? That's the ultimate third rail, right? So I hesitate to use that. But what I will close on this thing, if you go to the last slide here, is that we don't think that there is a win-lose proposition here, that somebody's got to win or lose for us to both keep the national security interests at press and also do the right thing with the environment. And so we'll talk a lot about the things that are going on in the AOC, and one of them is to move Red Hill. And if it comes to the fact that that's an issue, we are going to look at that, and we are looking at that. But right now, near term, for my time here, that's not going to happen between now and next summer when I take off. So the focus for us is going to be really, how do we make the best of our current situation? How can we keep our thumb on that national security pulse while at the same time keeping the drinking water safe both now and into the future in Oahu? And with that, I am going to step off the stage.
Thank you, Captain X and Captain Hayes. Thank you very much. So at this time, we move into our Q&A portion of the meeting, which will conclude at about 8:35 p.m. So there will be a combination of both written and oral questions for those who have either signed up to ask a question or submitted a written question. Each person will be given 2 minutes to ask a question. So in the best interest of time, so that we can answer as many questions as possible, please adhere to these time limits. A yellow card up here will signify that your time to ask a question is almost up, and a red card indicates that your time has expired. Once again, I thank everyone in advance for your reverence in communicating in a respectful and a productive manner this evening. Please direct all questions to a panel of subject matter experts who will be seated up here shortly, and I will take this opportunity to introduce our panel who will be answering your questions this evening. So of course we have Captain Rich Hayes, his regional engineer, Commander Navy Region Hawaii, Captain Ken Epps, Fleet Logistics Center, Pearl Harbor, Mr. Steve Linder of the Environmental Protection Agency, Mr. Bob Palarino, also of the Environmental Protection Agency, Mr. Omer Shalev with the Environmental Protection Agency, and Mr. Steve Chang, State Department of Health. So at this time, we're going to start. I just have a few questions that were written, so we're going to get through those very quickly. And here's the first question. So again, if you could please direct your questions to our panel. And the first question is, and it's by an anonymous person, it says, is the number and location of groundwater monitoring wells sufficient to assess contamination at this scale?
Steve Linder from EPA. I'll start by answering this question. So there are currently additional wells being drilled as we speak, the planning for, well, two wells are being completed, two additional wells are going to be put in. So the answer is we need more wells, and more wells are being drilled. As we get the data, we evaluate the data and evaluate our understanding of the information to determine what additional data is necessary. Environmental investigations are an iterative process. You gather data, you evaluate the data, you make decisions where it's best to put the next set of wells, the next, collect the next data. So
When
we
will
we have a complete understanding, and we're trying to figure out how.
When
we never have what we call a complete understanding. You've got to get to the point where you have sufficient understanding for.
When will the current set of wells be completed?
And how many?
Since the leaks occurred, we've already installed 4 wells. 2 of them are already in operation, and we're taking water samples from them now. The next 2 we have completed, and the first round of water samples will begin this month, I think around October 16, 17. And so those wells will now be in service. And we have 2 additional wells that will go in next, anticipating those will be complete in early 2017.
Thank you, Mr. Linder. So, and Captain Hayes. Our next question is from Mr. H. Doug Matsuo.
That would be me.
And his question reads, what health effects will appear in the community as a result of fuel pollution of the water supply? How will it affect adults, children, the unborn fetus, and animals and pets?
Again, there, as I mentioned earlier, there is no measurable fuel pollution of the water supply above any regulatory standard. The Red Hill Shaft drinking water supply that serves the Navy has had historically some trace detections well below any health-based standard set by EPA and the state.
Well, listen, you know, this question was asked the last time, and that's not really my question. We know that from the figures that the Navy themselves have produced is that between 1947 and 1985, 206,000 gallons of fuel has leaked from there, right? Nobody knows where that went. You have some monitoring wells. Well, if the pollution gets into the water, what will you be looking for? What kind of health, ill health effects will you be looking for? Will people, you know, will it be an increase in tumors? Will it be an increase in birth defects? Will cats and dogs start, you know, running around in circles? What? That's what we want to know, because we want to know what to look for in our communities if there's pollution in the water from these leaking fuel tanks.
So,
what health effect? What are we looking for in terms of detrimental health effects? Should we be looking for?
Water being tested on a regular basis. If the water has pollution, the water will not be used as
look, what if you miss it? What should we be on the lookout for in terms of the health of our people?
We gave the Navy. We are committed to ensuring the water safety.
Okay, then you don't know and you're not going to tell us. You know,
okay, so we made this statement, but I don't think, you know, we're not going to let it get to the point that dogs are running around in circles. I mean, we will, before it gets to that point, we will have indications from our water.
Yeah, what are we looking for in terms of health defects? Should we be aware of what happens? What happens when fuel gets in the water and we drink it? What do we look for? What's going to happen? Is hair going to fall out? Tumors increase? What?
I think I understand your question. I'm named Bob Pellegrino with EPA. Now, I'm not a toxicologist, but I have some information. So let me just answer your question.
Yeah.
So what you're saying is this contamination that exists that's coming from Red Hill, how will we know whether or not it's affecting us?
What will it affect if you guys don't catch it? That's what I want
to
know. Yeah, it was my question. I'm asking my question.
I'm trying to answer it. So in order to have ill health effects, there has to be some way for that contamination to be getting into your body.
Right. What are the health effects? That's all I want to know. What are the health effects of jet fuel?
If it was benzene pollution that you were being exposed to, you would have a certain risk of developing
increased cancer.
And we'd be happy to share. There is data and studies on health effects of fuel. There's an agency called Agency for Toxic Substances.
You can't tell us. You're protecting us from this risk. What is the risk?
To provide you the reports that describe it.
Tell us what it is. Already we know increased risk of cancer, birth defects. I mean, what? You can't tell us.
So I think if you go back to the slides of the folks that were involved, we have a lot of experts that are overseeing us.
Great.
Do you want the answer?
We want the answer. What are the health effects?
There's a table over here. One of them is the Board of Water. water supply, your own Board of Water Supply. He's a subject matter expert and part of the process for the AOC. I'm sure that they are watching the results that we post on the website to the Department of Health, and if we get anywhere near being anywhere close, I am sure the Board of Water Supply is going to raise an alarm and say, hey, we do not want to drink that water. But well before we get to any point where there's going to be birth defects or anything like that, we're going to tell you that the water's not safe to drink. And Navy's going to be committed to come in and put some sort of filtration device to remove that contaminant. So we will not get to that point.
We are at Navy.
Thank you. So
we're nowhere near at that point right now. The water is safe to drink.
Just as a reminder, in the best interest of time, we'll allow for one follow-up question to a question. So we want to just keep everyone on track. We do have some people who actually have questions and want to come up and share questions.
Go to the next guy.
So we want to make sure we stay on track. So I have a couple more cards, and then we'll get into that portion. So this is from Rachel Kylie Anu, and her question is, what does the Sierra Club, Board of Water Supply, and Board Health gain by exposing the neglect of the Navy's involvement in covering up that our health and livelihood is in jeopardy? And how do we stop passing the buck or blame and fix this problem?
Fix the problem. Board of Water Supplies,
right here. Board of Water Supplies.
Board of Water Supplies.
Yeah, what we'll do, folks, is we'll have a time after following this Q&A segment. These questions are specific to Redfield and updates and information. So we'll have some folks that will be out there with the poster boards following.
We have the Board of Water Supplies.
So the next question that...
Yep.
The problem is we're pointing finger at somebody. We want somebody to take the blame. What we need is, how are we going to work together and get the damn thing fixed?
How are you going
to
work?
Yeah, because that's the error. What are we going to do to fix it? The people that say you guys covering up, if you're covering up, we need to know. I mean, if everybody's deeper and everybody gets something that they're pointing to the next person. My question really is, how are we going to get it fixed?
How are we going to get it fixed?
All the groups together, so we all safe.
That's right. Thank you.
And that's the process we're going through right now with the AOC. I mean, we develop a product that gets reviewed by the regulators, to include the subject matter experts that are over here, the Board of Water Supply. And honestly, they've been very critical of the products and the stuff that we've done so far. We welcome that as comments. We just added a scope of work for our Section 6 and 7, which is going to cover the groundwater monitoring and the flow. We've got 51 pages worth of comments. I don't think there's any doubt that there's oversight.
Talk about that.
There's oversight to the process and things that we're doing today to ensure the water safety.
Okay, and our next question is, should the facility come under military attack, how many direct hits would it take to destroy the facility, render it null to void?
Okay, so I'm going to jump on that one. So the answer is, nobody knows. When I have been given my tours before at Red Hill, I've had the question asked at least twice, if a nuclear bomb hits Red Hill, what's going to happen to us? And what I'd say to them is, if a nuclear bomb hits Red Hill, we got bigger problems on Oahu than what's happening with Red Hill. Tongue-in-cheek aside, Red Hill was built expressly to survive a kinetic attack like a bomb or someone, you know, flying a plane into the mountain. That was the whole, if you watch the video, you'll see this now, which I'm sorry we didn't have it, but the whole purpose in 1940 was to prevent our enemies from knocking out our fuel supply, causing huge fires and the environmental, you know, hazards from that. So the whole purpose of Red Hill is to physically protect the fuel reserves in deep into the mountain. Okay? So, to answer your direct question, part of the study that is being done in the AOC is to look at a risk analysis. Let's just rip the covers off and figure out what are the worst case things that could happen to us here on Oahu in Red Hill, whether it's a massive earthquake, whether it's a chunk of an asteroid, whether part of the space lab falls on Red Hill. We're going to look at that and determine scenarios to figure out what is going to happen. But in general, the bomb question, that's the whole reason for existing of Red Hill. It was built to be shielded from someone who wanted to take out our supplies using some kind of explosive force, whether a bomb or they flew a plane into the mountain.
1940s.
Okay, we're going to move into our verbal questions now. So just as a reminder, we're going to have our cards up here. So once you see the yellow card come up, your time is almost expired. And once you see the red, your time is expired. So our first verbal questioner is going to be DeMont Connor. And if we could please have Larry Barrett and Don May on deck, because they're going to be following him. Thank you, Mr. Connor.
No more batteries.
Hello.
Aloha.
Hi, my name is Mark Conner, and I look around the room and I see nothing but Americans here. And for me, I'm a Kanakamoi. I'm a Hawaiian national. So I'm probably the minority in the room. For me, there's nothing more better I would like to see than the entire military leave our country. However, I also believe in a fair fight. And I believe that if you're doing something wrong, you should be called out on it. I was going over all the informational packages over here. One of the best information packages I've seen yet put out is by the Sierra Club. Shout out to Sierra Club. And specifically by Joshua Norman. So, don't clap because you might not like it. But anyway, it says, since 1943, over 200,000 gallons of fuel have leaked from radio. That's an amazing amount of gallons if you just look at it. But if you look at the year, 1943, and I say, wow, that's 73 years. 73 years, you would think that there'd be three-headed babies running around Honolulu Valley. You would think that the high risk of cancer would be higher here than on the west side. I live on the west side. I have leukemia. I lived there only 5 years and now I get leukemia. I believe it's because of depleted uranium that your military has put into the Namaku Valley. But yet we don't see those problems here in this area. I spent over 17 years in Halawa Valley, in Halawa Correctional Facility, in the high and in the medium. Never had this problem of this cancer until I got out to live in the Waianae Coast. So seeing that, I don't really see a real big problem. I don't know where the fire is. What I have a problem with is, I don't like you guys being here, I want to know that if something was to happen, North Korea, they want to bomb Hawaii, United States, cut off the shipping lanes. You said you get 12,500 gallons that they can hold, one tank. That means that we can have portable drinking water for all of us. That means we can have energy to fuel our islands. How long would it take for the entire facility to be depleted should our energy get cut off by some kind of bomb or something like that? How long would we be able to last? Because I don't like you being here, but you have a responsibility to take care of us. If that facility is not there, who else can take care of us? So I don't know if you can answer.
Thank you.
Yes,
sir. I'll take that. There's a lot in that question. There's a lot in that commentary. And a lot, none of us can answer. So I'm speaking for them without letting them. They can't answer that. The one last question you left was, how long can that petroleum, I think, keep Hawaii going if we were to get cut off from power? We don't have that answer. So we could look and get back to you. You could probably guesstimate if we were just to take a science test from UH and determine, you know, rough order of magnitude, how much stuff is in the mountain. Then we can calculate how many people live on Oahu. Then we can calculate on a per capita basis how much petroleum do we each consume on a day-to-day basis to kind of get through life. We would assume that in a catastrophe, we would cut back a little bit so it wouldn't be full throttle using it. And we could probably extrapolate, you know, how long we could live off of, and I say that in air quotes, off radio. We've never done that study though, sir, just because the primary purpose of the Red Hill was, again, if we had a disaster here, we could support the Coast Guard and other things coming to help us here on Oahu. But I don't think we've ever twisted the question of the scientists to make it a little bit more of a darker scenario that you lay out, which is, what if all of a sudden we're cut off? And if we were cut off and all we had was water and fuel to live on, I think we're using the fuel up there as if it were like kerosene, but I'll run with that. We haven't done that. But I think if you and I got together later on and we just kind of laid that out, we could probably figure it out in an hour or two. It wouldn't be scientifically accurate, but you could guesstimate about what that could do for the people on the island in a hypothetical scenario. And on the rest of your stuff, sir, I'll have to talk to you offline on that. Again, that's not my expertise or our expertise up here. We're really focused on Red Hill and the AOC. But again, afterwards, we will be more, I will stay behind as long as possible and try to answer whatever questions you have toward the military as we're representing the military here.
Next, we'd like to have come forward Mary Beard, please.
Hi. I live in Foster Village. I'm here tonight as a private citizen, but I am on neighborhood Board 18. And a lot of the stuff that was talked here tonight.
Microphone.
Can you
hear me? No, you got to pop into it.
Yeah.
It's directional.
There's a lot of things that we brought up that are people with Board 18. And a lot of it has to do with the wells of the water. We had brought Mr. Lau and his people to our neighborhood Board 18 in February. We got him to admit that water was not contaminated. We found out that the well that we get our water from is up on the side of the hill. The tanks stand 250 feet deep in Red Hill. It's only 120 feet from sea level. Then they say it's 100 feet down to the water for something's wrong. You can't be 100, or you can't be 20 feet from salt water and say we have drinking water. This isn't, everything you guys are talking about here tonight, and what I see and what I read about, it doesn't all add up. If we're getting our water from the top of the hill, that means the fuel that leaked has to go uphill. We can't do it. It flows downhill. It flows downhill 100 feet. It's in the brackish water that flows into Pearl Harbor. Everybody here is saying, oh, we don't have good clean water. That's because that gentleman right there, back months ago, said, and he's the head of the Board of Water. Then his chemist comes out and says, no, it's okay to drink it. But it stimulated all this conversation and all this problem. Yes, there is a problem with the leaks. They should not happen, ever. But they're not leaking into our drinking water like he's saying, because our well's up on the side of the hill. Now, if the fuel's leaking into the water that you have a well in, and the well's in Honolulu, I understand that. But don't tell me my water coming from the side of the hill is contaminated by the water that's down below us. It can't happen. The fuel can't flow uphill. You need to get out more information that's correct. And the Sierra Club is in bed with the Board of Water.
Please.
It's a private entity. That is a monopoly. We can't go anywhere else and get water. We have to go through the Board of Water. They raise our rate and then they turn around and spend millions of dollars to take these charges to the
best. Sir, your time is up, but in the best interest of time, do you have a question for our panel?
No.
Okay. Thank you for your
comments. This is absolutely factual, and it just goes to what the gentleman just said. So near Red Hill, there are three water supply wells. Two of them that are owned by the Board of Water Supply that feed the Oahu drinking supply, and one of them that feeds all the military people who live and work on Joint Base Pearl Harbor Hickam. In terms of distance, there's one north of the facility, just over, I think, 1.2 miles. There's one south of the facility, just over a mile. Those are the ones that are owned by Board of Water Supply. The nearest one to Red Hill is 3,000 feet from the bottom of Red Hill. That is the Navy's key water supply, and it happens to be located 3,000 feet down from Red Hill.
Okay.
I just want to add just also to that. So that's part of the AOC, is really understanding the groundwater flow and understanding the threat posed by Red Hill to these wells that were mentioned. So there's some uncertainty related to the direction of flow. The bottoms of the tanks are about 100 feet above the freshwater aquifer, but the direction of flow underneath the entire facility is not as well understood as we would like it to be. So that is part of the AOC. We're doing that work, putting in these wells to understand the flow, to assure that water supply wells are not at risk, and the Red Hill shaft is not at risk from releases from the tanks.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to the next three, have the other two on deck, please. It's going to be Don May, then we'll have Gary Hill, Sherry Pollock, and then Maka Alas-Evans, please.
My name is Don May. I'll try and be specific so you guys can give us a short. Every question I've asked, it seems to raise five or six more than others, so it's difficult. But the ones that bother me the most have to do with the welds on this patch in tank 5 that caused the 27,000 gallon leak. It was the most clear and present danger to public health. I'm glad that you mentioned that you had a quality assurance program. In the interest of full transparency, where is that available? Is that on your website? Can we look at your QA program?
No.
I'll have to look this up. What I'm hesitating about is it available? Do I know where it's at right here tonight?
I can answer briefly. That's part of the administrative order on consent, is looking at the Navy's tank inspection, repair, and maintenance process.
Exactly.
And as part of that, there is a report that is due. The Navy is on schedule to submit that report to the regulatory agencies on October 11th, so in about 1 week. And that is supposed to contain a lot of the details in the QA procedures for Tank 5 specifically, and also the improvements that the Navy has completed to improve their QA process.
Thank you.
And that will be posted on our website.
As a part of that, of course, the basis of the QA program is the GMP's good maintenance practices that hopefully would be available. Mostly concerned with that because every GMP, every QA thing, the most important thing about welds is the x-rays are going to make sure that there aren't any voids that cause some kind of failure. So what happened? It turns out that I'm glad you brought it up that it was a shell because what every refinery, every power plant uses these same GMPs and uses similar x-ray material, and all of them have public access so that you can look at those x-rays. How come nobody picked up the bad x, and apparently no x-rays were done? How did you get past your that? And the bigger question, of course, is how about all the other welds that were done? You say that you went through, like Shell does, and we've looked at those x-rays in refineries. Sometimes, in the case of the San Onofre nuclear plant, it took a court order, but they are available to the public. And in the interest of full transparency, folks like me would like very much to pull up those x-rays and look and see if you have voids in other.
Thank you, Mr. May.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think that to answer what took as a question out of there, we had an over-reliance on the contractor's quality control program. I'll admit that we...
Your program.
The contractor's quality control program. So, the Navy does the quality assurance of the contractor's quality control. So we over-relied upon his quality control of the work that he was doing. Yes, we should have gone and done an over-the-shoulder assurance or verification, and we did not do an adequate job at doing that. So that was one of the lessons learned, that we went back and pointed to, hey, the cause of it was human error for tank 5. So we went back and had the contractor repair all the patches. We brought in a third party, independent of the Navy, to do verification now of this warranty work. And again, because we're concerned of all the past issues that we had, we're going to redo that whole effort again to make sure. And I believe as part of the AOC, we do share, I don't know quite know about the X-ray welds, but we do share the results of those inspections within the AOC.
Yeah, and one thing that I think is also to keep in mind for some of the previous repairs, that the Navy is required by the administrative order has to do regular tank tightness tests, and those are essentially done to test the integrity of the structure. And so, without getting into too much detail, it is one measure of the quality of the past work done in the tanks.
And we can't come look at.
So the results of those tank tightness tests were, some of them were available as part of the administrative docket for the proposed administrative order on consent, so they were available to the public, and they still are.
Thank you. We want to be sure that we have quite a few more people on the list, so if we'd really stick to our time frames. Next up, Mr. Gary Gill, please.
Hello, everybody. I'm Gary Gill. I formerly was the environmental director for the state of Hawaii, so I have some background in this. I want to keep it really simple. Three things: risk, timing, and trust. I think people are here concerned about the risk. Even if we hear that the water is safe today, what about tomorrow? What about catastrophically? The only way to reduce that risk to zero is to do away with red tape.
Yes.
Well, so if you have questions, ask a question.
Let him talk. Let him talk.
There are questions here. Okay. Short of reducing that risk to zero, the game here really is how do you reduce it to as much as is feasible or practical. We could cut the risk in half if we were to reduce the number of tanks currently holding fuel
in half. Yeah.
Currently, there are 20 tanks. Correct me if I'm wrong. I believe there are 15 that are filled. Going by your own analysis, what I heard, that 5 of those 15 have actually been upgraded. That means 10 tanks are filled now that have not been upgraded. So that's a big risk. Question: to reduce the risk, can the Navy reduce the number of tanks that are currently filled with gas? Second point, tied into that, timing, risk timing. One thing people are concerned about is it takes 20 years to get to the end of the AOC system.
So,
what about 10 years? If we reduce the number of tanks in service by half, we can cut 20 years to 10. That is a suggestion I'd like you to consider. And as to trust, can we trust the results of all the contractors and everybody? Oversight, transparency is important. Can we, as we take these samples from the monitoring wells, take a split sample, have the Navy test it, have the EPA and the DOH test it, and let the Board of Water Supply
But the question is, but the concern is, we have to determine from a bigger perspective what we need to have here for Red Hill to exist. Because at some point, the reason for existing and the risk mitigation will counteract each other. So that's why I talked about this earlier. Part of the process here, and this is above, I mean, this is above us here from the Navy perspective, is the why Red Hill and how much it takes to do that. Okay, so I don't want to confuse anyone here on this. So that there is a reason for it, and we have the amount of fuel in the mountain based on the reasons that I laid out. So if we were just to arbitrarily cut that in half, the question would be, would Red Hill still serve the purpose that it's intended to do because it's here?
So I wanted to add a little bit to that and give a little wider perspective. We're studying the risk posed by Red Hill. I'm not sure if reducing the number of tanks in half would reduce risk in half. I think the answer is probably not.
We, working with the Navy, have essentially encouraged them through the AOC process to hire a very expert-level contractor that typically does risk assessments for the nuclear power industry to look at nuclear power plants to make sure they don't pose a threat. That's the level of risk assessment we're doing here at Randall. The tanks are part of the risk equation, but there's other parts of the facility, like the piping. And that may actually be a greater risk than the tanks. We don't know that yet. We're studying that. But reducing the piping is the same no matter how many tanks you have. So this is an important aspect of the work we're doing. So we're really trying to find the vulnerabilities of the facility and make sure the resources are invested to correct those vulnerabilities. And as for the suggestion about split sampling, we are already in the process of working on a contract to start doing split sampling for some of the groundwater work at Red Hill to verify the Navy's results.
Okay, risk, trust, and speed.
Timing,
okay, just want to make sure. So we've had five tanks already gone through the modified API inspections and are back in service. The sixth tank, tank five, is currently midway through, or you know, we're doing that one right now. And just at the end of August, we awarded two task orders valued at about $35 million to do the next five tanks. So we are accelerating that. We did take lean forward with tank five still being out of service to go ahead and do the next five, targeting the ones that have, you know, been the longest period of time that since they have had an inspection. So we are committed to speeding that process up to at least go in and maintain, scan, assess the condition of the tanks that haven't been looked at. Risk and trust.
I want to address the trust issue as well, because that's, you know, that's our role, EPA, DOH, we're regulatory agencies. We're overseeing the work the Navy's doing. We are working hard to make sure there's adequate transparency. If you look at our website, DOH's website, there's a huge amount of information on there related to Red Hill that we put up there. We're reviewing the work the Navy's doing. If we see something wrong, we don't like it, we reject it. There's been some press about that recently about a plan for doing an investigation that we didn't like. We think it needs to be changed, be improved. And that's part of the process. We're overseeing them, and we welcome your comments all the time. We're open for comments 24/7.
Okay, so we did validate, we did talk about that this week. We met with DOH, EPA, Board of Water Supply, and they did bring up the split sample. So that'll be something we'll look at. I mean, we want to make sure that test is done, that there's a good analytical process so that they're done at the same time, using the same method, so that we can have trust in the results that we get, that they're
put up there. We're reviewing the work the Navy's doing. If we see something wrong, we don't like it, we reject it. There's been some press about that recently about a plan for doing an investigation that we didn't like. We think it needs to be changed, be improved. And that's part of the process. We're overseeing them, and we welcome your comments all the time. We're open for comments 24/7.
Okay, so we did validate, we did talk about that this week. We met with DOH, EPA, Board of Water Supply, and they did bring up the split sample. So that'll be something we'll look at. I mean, we want to make sure that test is done, that there's a good analytical process so that they're done at the same time, using the same method, so that we can have trust in the results that we get, that they're...
Okay, next up, we have...
I want to hear from the gentleman from the Board of Water.
He's going to have his turn to speak. He's on the list, actually, so he'll be able to share some input.
We have 15 minutes left.
Yeah,
let him speak.
Yeah, we don't need any more military.
We don't want more
military.
We don't want the military at all.
We don't want the
military. And so, just for earnings benefit, what was the question that you asked? What's that?
We're done.
We don't want to hold
you. Yeah, let him talk.
For fairness to the lady that asked the question, I said, what was your
question? She's asking you to ask another question.
So everybody could hear, what was your question again, ma'am, for earnings?
I want to hear
Please like to hear from the gentleman from the Board of Water Supply.
Yes.
Brown lives matter.
But I want to face everybody.
Yeah.
Hi. Good evening, everybody. Ernie Howe, manager and chief engineer of the Board of Water Supply. I'm sorry, I'm a little nervous to be in front of such a big crowd here tonight. I just want to say, first of all, mahalo for everybody coming out, because this issue of Red Hill is very important to our community. And for Board of Water Supply, we take safe drinking water very seriously. And this facility, I know it's one thing about this whole Red Hill issue, and I struggled with it from the very beginning, because it's very, very technical and very complicated. It's very hard for the regular person out there that's not a, I'm an engineer and I struggle with this, that's not, it may not be an engineer to understand what the situation there at Red Hill. But on review of the Navy reports, basically this is the situation. And I apologize if it creates more confusion. But basically the facility was built underground on that Red Hill Bridge. Basically in 3 years, from 1940 to 1943, 20 tanks, 250 feet high, 100 feet in diameter. They're separated by about 200 feet. The bottoms of those tanks, and this is really hard to understand, if you're looking at it sideways, if you were to cut a knife down the middle of the bridge and you were looking sideways, you would see that the bottom of these huge tanks, each holding 12.5 million gallons of fuel, are just 100 feet above the drinking water aquifer. In Board of Water Supply, we have about 90 different well stations around the island. So not everybody's going to get water that is from wells closest to Red Hill. Those two wells, Halaba Shaft and Honolulu wells, pump from the same aquifer that is connected to where Red Hill is at. So imagine the fuel tanks.
That's not true. You said yourself it's only 30 feet deep.
I appreciate the difference of room. I appreciate the difference of opinion.
That's what you said.
You had your chance. His turn. Please.
No, because this is a Navy meeting, not a Board of Water Supply.
It's his turn. You had your chance. Be polite.
Tell him to say the thing and tell the truth.
Folks, we still have a lot of people that we want to hear from, so let Mr. Lau speak, please.
So let me continue, please. And I appreciate the differences of opinion. That is part of our society. We can share our knowledge. But at the end of the day, it is how we work together as a community.
He just grabbed her. I got it on film. He just pushed her.
Please.
No shame on you.
Folks, we want to make sure that we're communicating in a respectful manner. We would hate to break the meeting up and not be able to hear from everyone. So please, let's continue with the meeting, folks. Thank you.
Thank you. So, you know, I was saying the bottom of these huge tanks basically is 100 feet. Or if you think of the state capitol, everybody know the state capitol? If you were standing on the sidewalk and you looked up to above the state capitol, that 100 feet is about the height of the state capitol. And the bottom of those tanks really represents where it's directly located over the drinking water aquifer that our Halaba Shaft and Honolulu wells come from. And they provide, maybe not for certain people here in your community, if you live in urban Honolulu, that provides 25% of your supply all the way up to Hawaii County. So Board of Water Supply's concern is simply protection of our water resources. Article 11 of our Hawaii State Constitution clearly states, all natural resources are held in trust and must be protected for the benefit of the people of Hawaii.
Yes.
We're not talking about the people now, but we're talking about the people, our grandchildren, their children, for generations to come. Because we live on an island, we have a finite amount of fresh water resources, and the resources over which this facility sits are some of the purest resources in our system. As stewards of our public water utility, we must take this trust very seriously. So any negative impact on this drinking water resource, we take it seriously. And our concern is, there has been, in the 73-year history, a record of leaks. And this is not our information. This is not BWS information. This is what we've seen in the thousands of pages of Navy reports and documents, that there have been leaks. It's very difficult to quantify how much. But our concern, especially going forward in the future, is the potential for large catastrophic leaks of fuel. How much fuel is stored at Red Hill right now? There is, in the 15 tanks full of diesel and jet fuel, 187 million gallons. How much is 187 million gallons, if you ask? If you were to, anybody go to football games at Aloha Stadium? The Hawaiian Airlines field right there. If you look from sideline to sideline, goal line to goal line, 1 million gallons is 3 feet deep on that field. Multiply that by 187.
Oh.
You basically have a column of fuel over the Hawaiian Airlines field in Aloha Stadium that would be over 560 feet tall.
Right.
How tall is 560 feet? That is taller than the first Hawaiian Bank building on Bishop Street, which is one of the tallest structures in Honolulu.
Right.
So, is it leaking into our aquifer? Like, is a large amount leaking at this time? We don't know. We don't think so. We haven't been informed by the Navy or the EPA or the Department of Health that that's true. But our concern is about the future. What will happen to this facility? The thing that is containing the fuel in these tanks is quarter-inch steel plate that was installed between 1940 and 43. There are 68,000 square feet of steel plate in each tank. And I think it's over 2 miles of weld connecting those steel plates together. And that is our concern. It's this potential of a future catastrophic leak that could affect our drinking water resources. Will it reach Halawa Shaft? Nobody knows. Halawa Shaft is one of the largest pumping stations we have in our system, and we pump from the same groundwater aquifer. So Board of Water Supply, we're not responsible to implement corrective measures at Red Hill, but we are responsible there to provide critical recommendations to the Navy and EPA and Department of Health, which we have been doing.
Let him speak.
No.
I give him my 2 minutes.
We want to hear it.
I give him my 2 minutes.
You
get 4 more minutes. I give him my 2 minutes.
We'll give you 1 more minute, Mr. Lau.
No, I give him my 2 minutes.
He gave 2 minutes and there was no.
So, yes, I can. Go ahead.
Please proceed, Mr. Lau. Thank you.
Mahalo. Let's maintain aloha here.
Yes.
My concern is, you know, we need to be involved in this process. Like I said, we're not responsible to implement, but we're providing the input, and hopefully the solution will be something that we feel comfortable. For BWS, we really don't want any more fuel leaks from Red Hill.
Yes.
And we want the restoration of the aquifer below the facility, which is already contaminated. So zero risk of fuel leaks to the environment, relocation or retrofitting tanks with double walls. But we are committed to work with these parties. They've given us the opportunity to do that without signing a confidentiality agreement, which we really appreciate. But we need to stay on this. We thank the Department of Health and EPA for rejecting the scoping submittal that the Navy submitted back in May for sections 6 and 7. That was an 877-page submittal, and the EPA were glad, actually, and the Department of Health had many of the same concerns that we had. And I feel, in a way, it's validation, because they incorporated the entire contents of our June 3rd letter on that 877-page document into their rejection letter. So, mahalo, we are committed to work with the Department of Health and the EPA, and to, with Aloha, persuade our Navy to do the right thing. We respect their needs for fuel in Hawaii, but we feel that we need the precious mine, and that is irreplaceable. There is no substitute for pure water.
Thank you. You know, we've been working together on this since about March 2014. We continue to appreciate your involvement
and your experts involved in it to help us come to the right solution. I think the thing to keep in mind is a lot of these answers in terms of what kind of catastrophic failures can occur, what are those consequences. We're trying to figure that out. We're trying to understand the risk. And we're doing a lot of work right now. And that's really what we're here to talk about. So what we're doing, we don't have all the answers yet. We don't know what that risk is. So we shouldn't make assumptions about massive amounts of danger from the facility. Drinking water has been safe. There's no indication that it's ever not been safe from any of the water supply wells due to red hill. And we're going to continue to work to gather the information necessary to ensure that their wells continue to be safe into the future.
Thank you.
We have 6 minutes.
I'd just like to thank them as well to show, the accountability the Navy has and the involvement, collaboration we have with the Board of Water Supply. The gentleman over here previously asked for trust. We're showing the trust that we have to be held accountable by everyone here.
Okay.
We'll give you 2 more minutes. We have 8 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, we'll extend the time a bit. So we're trying to get to as many of our questioners as possible. So next up is Makaala Slavins. And if we could have Wally Ito, Henry Curtis, Kawi Lucas, and Moby Kaili Anu on deck, please. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My question actually comes in perfect timing because it's in regards to the 800-page work plan that was released by the nations. The question is posed to the EPA, and my question was why, what were the particulars as to why it was rejected? If you could elaborate on that a little bit.
So we're asking for more detail and a better definition of the process of doing the work. In addition, the plan did not describe in detail an iterative process that's typically done in these types of investigations. Like I mentioned earlier, typically in these environmental investigations, you gather data, you analyze it, you understand what that means, and you go back and you figure out what additional data you may need to come to adequate solutions. That part of the process was not clearly defined, so those are the general reasons why we rejected it. And like I said earlier, or I mentioned earlier, we had couple days of discussion with the Navy on how to change that plan in the last several days, and one of those days we included water supply in those discussions.
Okay, is Mr. Wally Ito here? Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity. I first want to model these informational boards, research. Really good. I had several questions coming in, and the questions already answered by these boards. Also, hello to the people who answered my questions. I hope I was maybe I spoke a little bit like I was upset, but please know that it wasn't personal. One of the questions that I had coming in was these monitored wells. The question was whether they went all the way down to the aquifer. The answer was yes. And so that kind of upset me because you're monitoring the water that we're eventually going to be drinking. I learned that it's monitoring wells upstream from our drinking wells. So just because we're finding fuel contamination in these monitoring wells, that doesn't mean we're actually drinking the water. But it's kind of upsetting that the contaminants are already in the aquifer once we detect it. And talk to geologists and environmentalists, and they have geological mitigations for that. They come up with biological and environmental mitigations for that before we get to the drinking part. But I don't think that's enough. So the question is there a physical process that can eliminate these contaminants from the drinking well, from aquifer before it gets to our drinking water? That's number two. I like that board about alternative options. I mentioned to several people, I'm 62 years old. These tanks are way older than I am. I don't think they were made to last forever, And so I wanted information boards about the the U.S. concerned about the maintenance and testing. That's great, but these things are not going to last forever. I've been like that before about alternative methods, alternative containers. And so the question, we talked about this radio being unique in the world. What do other naval installations do as far as storage fuel tanks, and can we use that technology or that technique? Can we really our radio, which is 100 feet from our aquifer? That's really scary.
Thank you, Mr. Kito. Thank you.
Good question.
I'll talk a little bit about the first one. So are there mechanisms where it's contamination that has been found that's below the tanks? Is there something going on with that fuel that would basically cause it to disappear before it gets to a drinking water level? And that's something that we're actually studying as part of the AOC, but typically that does happen with petroleum. Petroleum is naturally occurring. It's mined out of the ground from wells. There are microbes, bugs in the environment that have been eating petroleum-related constituents for as long as we've had petroleum, basically. So it really is looking at the rate of which that contamination would break down and the amount that could be broken down by the naturally occurring nutrients in the subsurface.
So, the question was, is there a physical process to remove that if it comes to a point where the natural processes cannot handle it?
So the natural processes can. You can treat water contaminated with petroleum fairly readily using technologies like activated carbon filter. So for example, I believe Water Water Supply, if you have some treatment on some of your wells and other parts of Oahu where there are residual pesticide available, is that correct?
Yes, we treat at 12 different locations. These are pesticides that was used by Pineapple and Sugar for many years. And for the last 30 years, we have been treating the water in Central and leeward Oahu to remove those pesticides to safe levels in the water. We use about 1 million pounds of activated carbon a year to treat that water. I guess at Red Hill, I know that the Navy has done a study in 2010 that looked at carbon treatment and its aeration of the water to evaporate out the petroleum contaminants.
Okay, I'll answer your two questions.
Pretty easy. One was, what are other facilities doing? It's a mixture of above ground tanks and below ground tanks. So what's unique about Red Hill is that it's just the size of it here. But we have a combination of both. Second question you asked is, the tanks weren't meant to live X amount of time. And I don't know that I would agree with that. We use the analogy to akin to the Hoover Dam, that it was built without a terminus date, and that we would invest more money and resources over time to upgrade, rehabilitate, and modernize. But it wasn't a fixed date, and somehow we've gone past that expiration date.
Thank you. Mr. Henry Curtis, please.
Aloha. I'm Henry Curtis, Executive Director of Life of the Land. From 96 to 2005, I was community co-chair of the Hickam Air Force Base Restoration Advisory Board, spent a decade on the Pearl Harbor grab. So I'm familiar with this kind of stuff and the Air Force cleaning out their pipes from Wahiwa and YPO. I'm also familiar with some of the cutting edge issues and solutions the military has used, as well as some of the disasters, such as Pearl Harbor's Walker Bay, which had 1,500 times the dioxin level for a residential cleanup level, which remained uncharacterized and untreated for a decade. The most toxic, hazardous material in the world, except for nuclear weapons, untreated for a decade, no boundary established. So, pluses and minuses. The two questions I have is, you said that there are certified API 653 engineers who screwed up. My first question is, how much was the fine and the jail term?
That's right.
Yeah.
second point deals with the Board of Water Supply, which I have always found to be a very effective organization here.
Yeah.
When there was contamination in Village Park, the community there asked for the before treatment and the after treatment contamination of the water supply. The Board of Water Supply did not have to supply that information, but did so. The question is not whether the drinking water supply is safe, which it is, but whether the Board of Water Supply will share the pre-treatment contamination levels at Red Hill.
So the first one, the question about penalties, so I don't think we know that answer right now. We'll have to get with our lawyers and look at the public domain, but I've never researched that, so I don't have that answer.
Was there one? Was there a fine?
We awarded the contract for that effect. We wanted to keep the contract on board through the warranty phase. So we have not closed out that contract yet. He is not getting any future work, or we haven't gone through that process. But if his contract is not closed, there definitely is much more legal between the Navy, the contracting officer, myself, and the contractor. But we have not fined him to yet, because we want to hold him accountable and get him across to do the warranty work and not have him potentially walk off the jobs. So it's still a lot of legal stuff to go with the contractor.
Thank you very much. Now we have Kawi Lucas. Is Kawi here? Thank you.
Thank you all for coming here and giving us this opportunity. I was really surprised because I've been following this a little and have done some research with the Honolulu Board of Water Supply to hear that there was one event and that the contaminants were well below any sort of problem levels. The reports that I saw from the Department of Health via the Board of Water Supply tell a different story, that there have been many events over the years, and actually subsequent to the one in which you referenced, the 2014 event, there was one in April of 2015. And the last time I asked the Board of Water Supply, they did not have any answer for what caused that. The spike in contaminants was equal to the 2014 event, and Board of Water Supply didn't find out about it for 6 months. It was 6 months before they got the information from the Department of Health. So I heard a lot about reporting and accountability and these freaking monitoring systems. I'm very excited. But if it takes 20 years to get those in place, I worry about next week. Because it wasn't just one event. I'd also like to share a vision. I have a vision for this Red Hill that it is the most amazing tourist attraction since Pearl Harbor. There are tours going from up that 3-mile tunnel. Wouldn't that be fabulous? I mean, wouldn't you pay $8? You just build it right in. You know, you have the Arizona, the Missouri, and the Red Hill fuel tanks.
Thank you, Miss Lucas. Thank you.
Quicker.
Thank you.
So, yeah, we recognize concentrations vary over time. That increase, we have not equated that to a new rule.
variation in the concentrations measured. And any type of site like this, you typically see variability in the concentrations measured. But you're concerned about how quickly we get data. We share that concern at EPA and DOH, and we are working to try to change the requirements and expedite the production of data so that we see the data closer to when the sample was collected. We also don't want to wait to see that data. And as we talked about earlier as well, we are in the process of putting a contract together to do split sampling. So that will be data collected by our lab, or samples collected by our contractors, analyzed by our labs, and we'll have that data probably faster than the Navy and be able to get that out quickly so that people know what's happening as close to real time as possible.
So does that mean that a year after that 2014 event, the contaminant spike could happen? I mean, because the levels were higher a year later.
Yes, it could happen.
Okay, now I just want to clear one thing you brought up, so just for the record, this is me just reporting the public record. So since 1988, EPA has required all fuel handling facilities to report any leaks over 1 gallon. Since 1988, we have had two releases in Red Hill. One was for 6 gallons, and we had to report that to DOH and EPA, and the second one was in January of 2014, the one I talked about earlier. So we wanted to make sure that we're talking about constituency readings and spills, those could be independent events.
So the fact that they were hundreds of times over the level of acceptable health doesn't matter?
It does matter. So when we get those test results, there are steps that we take and report to the Department of Health. So one of the questions you had was the time. So it takes us right now about 3 months from the time we sample the water to send it off and get it back. So that's one of the things that the EPA said, hey, we need to do a better job at it and get quicker. So that was one of our concerns of why we were wanting to focus in on the contaminants that we test for so we could turn it around quicker. In the interest of trying to be open and transparent and that you can trust us, we send the test results off to an independent validator to have them validate the test results, so it wasn't us doing that, so that we could say, hey, they're independently validated. That process added more time on. The Department of Health said, hey, we want a verbal notification before it goes off to the validator. So we're working with them to shrink that time down. We post it to the public. As soon as we get those final results back, we post it to the Department of Health, it's put on their website. It's available to the Board of Water Supply. It's available to everyone in the room.
I think there's one last thing to clear up, is that there are various levels at which pollutants can be found in the monitoring wells. And they trigger different subsequent actions. Some of those actions are reactive and some of them are proactive. So if something goes above an action level, for example, which has happened here, then there are additional actions that the regulatory agencies pursue and require of parties such as the Navy. And then there are site-specific risk-based levels which are developed in conjunction with that. And those trigger different actions afterwards. So that health, it's different necessarily than a health-based level. Some of them trigger actions in terms of additional things that the Navy must do in order to make sure that the facility is operating safely.
Okay, thank you. I just want to mention, we do have a time limit on the use of this facility, so we have a few more people we want to hear from, and we do need to wrap this up in a few minutes. So for those of you who are coming up, if you could really keep your questions focused so we can be sure to hear from everyone. So if you could have Momi Ka'ilanu, please. Thank you, Momi.
Certainly, there is a claim. It's certainly 11 points.
did say you guys weren't going to mow, but is there any chance that the rest of us can mow those 11 points? That's my
They, just real quick on that one, their letter is posted on their website with all.
Okay, so but I just came to this meeting because there was so much things happening and I just reading it. So that's why I'm asking this question. That's why. 2 a.m. for the World Water Supply. It's been brought to my attention. Is it true or false that you guys are drilling 2 monitoring wells costing $700,000 each? Next to 2 navy wells. That's the second question. And the third question is, who reports to who? Who's the governor? Like all the legislature, eventually we all go to government. Who do you report to for us, the people, find out where it who's on the top and then what's going on? What number are you?
Rejection letter for section 6 and 7 by the EPA and Department of Health. We are drilling monitor wells to create what we call an early warning system to give us an advance warning if fuel is migrating from the Navy property and moving toward our wells. So there is one well that we have to open the bids and we've awarded the contract. It is not $700,000, it's $360,000 to drill that well at our Honolulu 405 reservoir site. We see the need for wells in the Halawa Valley, which is in the direction from Red Hill toward our Halawa shaft. There is no real sentinel wells or early warning system there. We're glad to see in the rejection letter by the EPA and Department of Health that they recognize the need for a sentinel or early warning system of monitor wells around the facility. And if the Navy were to proceed with that, a Board of Water Supply would depend on their efforts. But we have plans to continue to move forward because we can't wait until we detect it in our drinking water source. At that point, it's too late. We need advance warning of any fuel movement underground that might be coming in our direction. We need advance warning of years to be able to prepare alternative actions such as development of a new source someplace else, not near the Red Hill facility, or insulation like at the Navy study of 2010 of a carbon and air stripping treatment system to remove the petroleum. So ma'am, I hope I answered your question.
Thank you. So just a reminder again, we really need to wrap things up here in the next 8 minutes. So if everyone coming up will be very brief so we can make sure we hear from everyone. So who we have on deck now is Claire Loprinzi, and then following her will be Representative Laura Thielen and Mr. Marty Townsend, and then Dave Mullins. So if you could, if you're still here, is Claire here? No? Oh,
yeah,
there you
are. I'm here.
Thank you.
Aloha, I don't mean at all, I'm a very passionate person. I'm a traditional midwife. I have kuleana and I have accountability, I say you. And I just came back all the way from the islands where I come from, and I live on the Big Island. I'm here because I'm concerned. And I'm learning, and I've been doing this a long time. I'm in my 60s. I just came from Sicilia. I have a hard time, and I'm gonna ask you my questions, and then you don't need to ask them right now. You can put them up on your website, because I think they're good questions. 1943, Eisenhower gave Pohjolahti and said it had to be left in a habitable condition. It is not. And then you've now moved to Pohakoloa, our temple. Our temple
of all of Polynesia, which happens to fly over my head as 126,000 come in and bomb us, depleted uranium. I speak also for birth sovereignty. I am a traditional midwife. We have medical doctors. We have medical doctors on ground right now that are keeping our birth statistics. Why? Because we've been asking for 10 years for birth statistics. I have been filling out birth statistics for over 40 years. If you guys gave up the birth statistics, we would be winning every battle that we are working on right now. So when you say that you malama this aina, underneath that water, gold star ancestors, those are our kohala, our whales, our dolphins. We eat some of the land, I mean the life in there, but we respect it. It was not you that's malami, but thank God to the Ninth Circuit Court on July 15th, which happened to be a great birthday present this year, they stopped the bombing. So when you say you are malami and taking care of our island, you are not. So it has to be true. You walk your talk, you are your word. You leave it better than you came. And that's not happening. You're destructing our lands. You are destructing us. And you are destructing many generations, which I happen to know these generations coming in, because that's the gift of a traditional midwife. We have carried our ways into 2016. So please stop. We want an island of aloha.
Well, your time is up, ma'am. So do you have a question for us?
So we want a Department of Peace. We want our islands to be restored. We know that there are 10,000 gallons of oil in Greenland right now. We know that you have 600 bases around the world. We know that it is worse to have
a super fund.
It is worse to have a super fund.
We're going to be taking some time on the next person, so if you could wrap it up, please. Thank you.
I'm respectful.
Thank you.
So the super fund funds are locking us into not taking care of things. So we want our land cleaned up, and we want to know, when are you going to clean it up?
Thank you. Thank you very much for your question.
When are you going to clean it up?
Rejected, and the Navy's going to have to go back to the drawing board. Because by pushing back,
that work product, we're pushing back every single deadline. So now we're moving from 22 years to what? And we're at year one. So we're already experiencing our first delay at year one. You know, I have some concerns. And the other question I have for the state is, do you, as Department of Health, view your role here as purely as the local arm for the EPA, or do you think you also have an additional responsibility under our state constitution to hold the Navy to a higher standard to protect the public trust resource of our water and future generations?
My last four speakers
speakers will have 30 seconds to please pose your questions so we can have them answered. So Marty Townsend, Dave Mullenix, Representative Cynthia Thielen, and Gina Hara. Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Marty Townsend. I'm the director for the Sierra Club employee. Thank you very much for coming tonight. Thank you very much for coming. I won't hide the fact that I hate these fuel tanks and I want them to be retired.
Yeah.
They should have never leaked, and they leaked, and they leaked more than once. And I think they've proven their record. But I also recognize that we don't actually have the political power right now in this room to get the tanks retired tomorrow. So I want to, like other speakers, I'm worried about tomorrow, next week. So I want to know, is the Navy committed to double walling the tanks? Double wall is the only way to ensure the tanks are leak-proof. And leak-proof is a minimum expectation. Will you meet that minimum expectation? Second, what are you guys going to do to get the money needed to double wall the tanks, ensure they are leak-proof, and then clean up all of the contamination, and that means however long it takes for you to find it, clean it up so that we don't have to worry about our drinking water supply, about our nearshore waters, about this ever having any harm to anything.
Thank you. Thank you.
We are committed to the tank upgrade alternative that the AOC determines is the best.
So will double walling be one of the...
Double walling, there's a slot in the back that
tank
identifies...
Tank inside of the tank.
Double walling tank inside of a tank is one of the alternatives
that is being considered as part of the AOC. So if that comes out to be the best applicable technology, then that's what we want. The second part, what are we doing to get the money?
What's the cost and where
are
we getting the money?
It'll cost, well, I don't have the exact number with me. Believe me, there's a lot of interest in DC and the folks that write that check as to how much that cost is. We've already given them preliminary, okay, we're going to need the money. They're committed. The commitment we got is they're committed to follow through with providing that. But that's a process way outside of anyone in this room.
So I recommend you'd be interested in for the Navy to have the tank be there because we're okay to that. I want to make sure you spend the money first on cleaning it up. So how do I make sure what mechanism is there to ensure that you guys have the funds you need to clean up whatever is still so that we do not have another number of money?
Very full loaded question, but we don't have the answer to that, first of all. So, but what we can share with you, as Senator Stevens says, this decision is above our pay grade here, so we're representing the Admiral, but this is above him too. But through this process, there are many interests, the Navy and the Defense Logistics Agency, who are willing to do what's right, to make what's right here. So I can meet you 90% of the way. I can't get that last 10% yet because we have to go through this process and figure that out. So whether it's double walling, you know, you need the cleanup, that has to be resolved in this process. But I can tell you that there is not reticence on our part. We want to see the facts, we want to see the science, and then we are willing to resource what we can in an appropriate fashion.
As soon as we finish or come up and finalize the tank upgrade alternative, I don't know the exact timeline, but within the National Defense Act that was signed, the Navy and the DOA have to go through the House Armed Services Committee, and they're the ones who would write that check.
On Monday, Columbus Day, I will be there at 4:00 with the Chief of Staff from one of those committees who are coming into Red Hill and to look at that. And I think I told you when I took you in this summer, the interest from DC and Red Hill has been off the charts in this last year than any time in its history. So you have the right interest, the right people are looking at it. If this all comes together, the right folks are willing to put some skin on skin.
If we could have Dave Mullenix, please, for running out of time, but we want to hear from the last three folks here. Thank you.
My time.
Representative Cynthia Phelan, and my question is for the Navy. Red Hill is not Mount Rushmore. Mount Rushmore has been carved in the mountain to last for centuries. Red Hill was built during World War II for the war effort and served that purpose. If you went out today to build those gas tanks at Red Hill, you would be prohibited from doing so under environmental laws. So my question to you is, when is the Navy going to ask Congress for funding to study decommissioning the tanks?
Okay, so the question was, when are we going to ask Congress to do a study on decommissioning tanks? I don't think that we have that in the queue now, but embedded in that question is the whole notion of, does Red Hill stay here or not? So I think it's answering the same thing. You want to decommission it or move it somewhere else. Part of this AOC
to do this study, take your first step to do this study.
Right.
You have to ask Congress for the money. I don't ever hear that being talked about by the Navy, and I think that that's something that has to go up your chain of command, up to the people to say, let's take a look at this, let's study it, and let's look at the fact that those tanks should be decommissioned. They are totally illegal under present environmental law. Of course, our Department of Health, I'm sure they know.
Yeah, really.
So my question is, when do you start that conversation going up the chain of command so Congress can have that issue before them to look at the concept of decommissioning the tanks?
Yeah, so we'll have to get together again at that because it's not currently on our docket.
Thank you for your question. And our very last speaker, one more minute, is Gina O'Hara. Thank you.
My name is Gina O'Hara. I was born and raised in this neighborhood. I'm 46 years old. And I feel like I can talk for my home neighborhood, who is from Special Projects in the Water. But I feel that when you talk about the flow direction, the drinking water, these issues is not what we are, that's like after it happens that we are contaminated. Already we are contaminated because we have a spill, and nothing was said about what are we going to do about that which was spilled, because in Hawaii we know that we have a water lens that takes 20 years and all the water will go to the lens. And everything is connected, and we always think about, like, you know, Native Americans think 7 generations. Everything is connected, and so we are really worried about it. And a lot of people couldn't come today, so I feel like I need to say that. And I wasn't very hopeful with the EPA because, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, I know you're trying your best, but when you say that petroleum is natural, and when you say that you're going to monitor something, it's not addressing what is really concerning us, which is, it is poisonous.
Yeah. Yep.
And it's next to our water. And all water goes to the ocean. It just doesn't disappear. And,
right.
And sometimes later on it's going to go out and it will affect our
something.
Kids.
Yeah.
Or grandkids or something like this. So I know you are not your parent, it's not your fault. And I don't want you to feel like I'm attacking you. But I want to ask a question, especially Department of Health and to the Department of Water, because you are from here and I know you are sincere. Are you doing enough? Because I know you are on our side, but I want to tell you about why the trust is a little bit shaky on this, okay? Because, for example, the department, you just said that the water is contaminated and other things, but yet we have so much GMO spraying, and the Department of Health doesn't seem like they are doing anything about talking about the
Right. Use
pesticide that eventually will go down. So this is a bigger issue, but I think we need to think holistically on this environmental issue. It's not just about fuel, because the fuel, holistically looking, because we live here, okay, the fuel eventually, have you looked in For example, Japan uses their sewer system waste to make hydrogen, and their whole system is run on hydrogen. Other countries are doing this. So maybe the question should be not only decommissioning the fuel, but thinking bigger. Like, how are we going to use, because military can spur a lot of innovation. Okay, so how are we going to be able to be sustainable as, I mean, military is not sustainable, but how can we make a good from this? This is the opportunity. This situation is forcing you to be next, jump to the level, you know what I mean?
Thank you.
Yeah, great question. We are south and water. So what I want to ask you, many people brought up the depleted uranium, and I haven't heard that in the news. I'm not saying that the news is very responsible these days. But it's not been addressed, that people are talking about it, and it is in the urine test of people on the big island and things like that. And also, when I asked the people here, I asked about the Pixvalent 6, which is chromium 6, which has been found, Hawaii is number 2 in the nation after the other large military base in Oklahoma. And nobody talks about that, and that's in the water. And we have to look for a filter for this. And this is in our drinking water. And so,
thank you, Ms. Hara. Thank you. Our time is up.
Okay, so that was my question to Department of Health and to Department of Water. Are you doing enough?
Are you doing enough?
Yeah. I'll go first and go for a second. Ma'am, those are very good questions. And I asked that question of myself too, in the situation of Red Hill. Are we doing enough for the water supply? And because of that, we still drive ourselves to do more by doing independent research that we can compare our results with what the Navy and EPA is coming up with. So we proceed to even drill our own wells, even though that is expensive and it's paid by ratepayers, because we get no tax revenue to do that. But we decided to do it because the question was, are we doing enough? And ma'am, I ask that question continuously. My staff and I always ask that question, and we'll continue to do that. On the uranium, we test all of our wells. I remember we have about 90 well stations around the island. The EPA, under the Safe Drinking Water Act, requires us to test for radionuclides. And what we find in our wells, those levels are at the level that is naturally occurring. We don't see any extraordinary high levels of radionuclides in our drinking water that exceeds the drinking water standards. So I hope I answer your question.
Pretty
I'd
good.
Be glad to talk to you afterwards in more detail. I'm going to be here until they close down the scaffolding. Thank you. Steve, your turn.
Thank you, Ernie.
Thank you.
My daughter shares her same passions. She tells me, says, "Daddy, you cannot retire. You have to keep working on this and make it better." And I'm like, "Oh, but I'm so tired already." The time I have here and working with my staff, we're committed to doing it. We're learning more things. Department of Health deals with the issues of depleted uranium with military test firing range and stuff like that. Looking at making sure that can we ensure that things can be safe. It's always a challenge because it's a lot of times it's a matter of resources fighting to get things done. So it's like, we just have limited resources. We're trying to get the best people we have to work on these issues. Our guys are really committed. They've learned a lot. We've had people that are retired from the military come work for us to share all the information they have. And we try to attack it at every possible different angle to see can we make it better. It's not an easy solution, but we can't give up. We can't give up on you, we can't give up on our future.
Thank you.
I just want to add one thing. I know we're not from here, but the reason why we're here is because DOH asked us to be here. We're here to help them. They saw this as a big problem. They recognize that we have national resources, and that's what we're bringing here to help DOH. But we're in constant communication and listening, and we're here because we want to do the right thing.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Again, in the best interest, we do need to be out of the school fairly quickly here. We'd like to say thank you to the Environmental Protection Agency, the State Department of Health, to the Navy, and to everyone here who came out tonight and shared their questions with us.
Wrapping it up here.
Thank you, everyone. And please
this
try
was the Navy's update on the Red Hill pollution situation, and part of their plan was recently rejected by Department of Health and EPA, but that wasn't addressed very much. Thank you.
I barely got here. You know anybody that's going into Kona? I mean into Kona.
I'm not sure. I don't know. I'm live. I'm going to interview people. What'd you think? I'm gonna grab. Right here, do you want to get a word in with Sierra Club people?
Hold on. I'm gonna ask, can you take a picture so I can be
well,
in it?
Well, I'm kind of. Only if I can hold it with one hand because I'm live streaming at the moment. Oh, you can go, maybe go around that side and that side.
Oh, it's nice.
Hey!
Back.
Okay, I'm back up.
One more. Get a word in with Joshua. Mama. Might not be possible. Thank you, Ernie.
No, thank you.
Hey, you're still live on the internet. Any comments, parting comments for people?
You know, tonight you heard a lot of different opinions about things, and it's okay to disagree. That's part of the process, but as long as we stay with Aloha.
Right.
This issue of Red Hill is very important, so I just would encourage the community to stay informed about it and look to the Board of Water Supply or the Department of Health or EPA for more information. Thanks.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for coming here. Appreciate it.
Okay.
I think we might be wrapping it up here. We overstayed longer than people thought. I thought it would go on, but we heard from former director of the Department of Health, and I'm going to cut out. Thanks for joining. I think I did.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm backing away here. I had a lot of comment. There was a lot of interesting public comment. I'm going to get out of here without getting run over. Thanks for joining us. I'll see you later. Appreciate you guys.